Hi, everyone. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Angelique Carson. I'm an editor here at the International Association of Privacy Professionals. We're coming to you today from our headquarters in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, and we're thrilled to be with you. I'm joined today by Cathy Scerbo, who is our Chief Information Officer, and Rita Heimes, our General Counsel and Chief Privacy Officer. And as you probably know by now, and as Brenda mentioned, we're talking today about where law and policy will collide in 2020. Just to give you sort of an idea of who we are a policy-neutral organization that is tasked with educating members of the privacy profession, helping them advance their careers, giving them the knowledge and information they need to do their jobs better. We have 55,000 members. We are in about 145 different countries, and we're on every continent but Antarctica. So that's a little bit about us. We're going to jump right in today, and we're going to try and take some questions throughout this presentation to help sort of facilitate discussion and to help you sort of get your questions answered in real time. So I'm going to turn it over now first to Rita, who's going to get us started a little bit on some key principles in privacy.
Well, thanks, Angelique, and thanks everybody for joining us today. I just wanted to amend the title of our session to Where Law and Tech Will Collide in 2020, and I think to set the platform, the framework for where I'm coming at this, and I'm coming at it with the background training in the law side of things, where Cathy is, I think, approaching it from the tech side. It might help to just do some level setting on what we mean by law, or what I mean by law. And for purposes of this discussion, we're going to cover some ground on what law might mean. It certainly means statutes like the California Consumer Privacy Act that's actually been passed by the state legislature. It could mean a regulation, which is a law coming out of Europe, like the General Data Protection Regulation. Those are actual positive statutory law and regulation that have been passed by bodies, elected bodies. But in the field of privacy and cybersecurity and certainly tech in general, there's a whole bunch of policies, if you will, and best practices. There's also layers and layers of contracts that assign responsibility and risk and liability between parties. And these are really at least as important in some ways as the regulatory landscape that we are starting to see come at us around data protection, around tech in general. So we have everything from the Illinois Biometric Protection Act, which is really a privacy law that clearly affects technology because so much tech now collects biometric data, which has a broad definition, all the way to our more typical garden variety data breach statutes that have been around for a long time. And in between, lawyers spend a lot of time negotiating how data will be used and transferred and deleted and how to respond to a consumer request. And that's sort of the day-to-day bread and butter of where most of us lawyers live. So we'll be talking about some of those things, but to start it all off, we want to go way back to some principles that were set by the OECD a long time ago in the 80s. And these are not the Fair Information Practice Principles, but if you kind of get your brain around what the policy community was trying to do and it realized that information technology, the information revolution, was going to create data effluent issues and consumer problems, they came up with some guidelines a long time ago, and these have woven their ways into the laws that we're seeing today. So collect only what you need. Minimize what you collect. Let the user know what you're collecting and what you plan to do with it. That's transparency. And also maybe sometimes ask if it's okay first before you collect and use their data in a certain way. That's the consent piece that we see in U.S. law under GLBA, the Gramm-Leach-Bliley Act, and HIPAA. Give them control over it. Maybe after you've collected it and started to use it, they could say, no, I don't want you to do that anymore. You can only do it in a certain way. And try, when you collect data, to use it only for the reason you collected it in the first place, and try not to use it for a bunch of other reasons that people may not expect you to use it for that might surprise them We've all heard, of course, of the Cambridge Analytica issue. That's a classic example of data being collected for one purpose that might have ended up being used for another, much to the surprise of the data subject. So these are some of the principles that we now see making their way into what we call positive law or statutory law, but they've always been there for a long, long time, and they still influence us today.
Yeah, and this is Cathy. Just from the technology perspective, starting to look at these key principles and how they apply to tech, in the spirit of the conversation of how tech and the law are colliding, you know, the last several years in technology, we've been huge in the big data, the age of big data, and we are collecting whatever we can to figure out how we can use it later. And data privacy laws are starting to say, nope, can't do that. You only collect what you need to process what I'm asking of you. And this is a place I think that's really going to ramp up understanding and knowledge and be critical for the engineers who are building applications, who are maintaining applications, who are looking at security needs and things like that to make sure that we're only literally collecting the data that we need. And then, of course, when I think about a lot of applications and how they're generated, we've got to ask permission, as Rita mentioned. We've got to start thinking more and more about what it is in the future we might do. So in the past, saying we're just going to collect everything and then figure out what we need or what we can do with it, now we have to start to say, what do we think we might someday want to do with it, and or what do we know today, so that we're asking right up front for that consent or that permission. And then, you know, user control comes in and the right to know, there's so much we can do in automation that just today we really aren't. Probably about what I'd say.
We have a couple of questions now coming in on CCPA, and I know that that's something that, you know, here at the IAPP, a lot of our members were tasked with, you know, making sure companies that they represent are compliant with the law, if not their own companies. Rita, maybe do you want to speak to a little bit on whether there are details on cybersecurity and data protection within the CCPA?
The short answer is no. The CCPA doesn't provide any technical details, and most laws won't. You'll be hard-pressed to find, lawmakers telling you what your technical standards should be. Most of them use things like reasonable or appropriate technical and organizational safeguards, you know, that are appropriate to the industry. But CCPA really is not about cybersecurity. It's really one of the very first privacy laws that has to do with the way that personal information is used by the company and what control that the user may have, ability to access it, ability to delete it, ability to find out if it's being sold and tell you not to sell it anymore. Those are unique and new to the CCPA, different from other statutes. The one piece of it that might have to do with cybersecurity is that it references the data breach law that's already been in place for a long time in California. California was the groundbreaker for passing a data breach statute, and it says that if there is something that constitutes a data breach under that law, there can be a lawsuit brought by class action plaintiff's lawyers to recover on behalf of consumers for that data breach. So it's not really a set of standards for cybersecurity, but it will have a pretty big impact on companies once it becomes enforceable.
Let's go to Cathy, moving on a little bit. I think one thing that might be interesting to this audience is that folks who haven't traditionally been tasked with privacy as part of their job are going to be increasingly tapped for that sort of role. You know, possibly that's what some of you are here to sort of hear about. People are asking me about, you know, are we complying with privacy, and that's not something you've really had to have a grasp on before. Let's talk a little bit about that, if we could, Cathy.
Sure. Yeah, and that's a great question. So I joined the IAPP a year ago, and I feel like this has been my journey. And I feel, from a technology perspective and a privacy engineering perspective, I feel there's a lot of us that need to catch up on this. I really look at security and privacy as hand in hand, for sure. Privacy requires that we secure the data and things like that. But from a pure engineering perspective, we do need to start thinking about privacy differently. When we are building our applications, we need to build in the ability for users to opt in, opt out. We need to opt out by default, things like that. We certainly, in this industrial revolution that we're in, we have new technologies that are creating data the way we never thought about data before in the past. Videos, pictures, facial recognition, biometrics, all those things are becoming data as we define in a privacy way that we haven't thought about in the past from an engineering perspective. So we really need to think about the progression of technology and how that's happening in changing data into different types of data into things that we need to worry about from a privacy perspective. Beyond that, there's things like machine learning where we will anonymize data to a certain extent, but we have to be very careful that we don't create situations where we can produce a data set that feels anonymized, but then we can marry it to something that's a public data set, perhaps, and then suddenly be able to create some identifiable data that does produce a privacy issue that we hadn't really expected. There's things like tracking, whether it's tracking on our websites or whether it's location tracking and the ability to do that, that can certainly be used for the what we consider the right reasons, marketing, things like that, but it can also be used nefariously if we're not careful. So there's a lot of things we need to start thinking about differently.
We've got a question here that maybe we can answer. Maybe this is for both of you. Cathy, maybe you could start us off talking about tech teams. The question is, are you finding a paradigm shift in where tech teams are starting to see the value of viewing security with a compliance mindset?
That's an interesting question. Viewing security with a compliance mindset. I honestly haven't seen that yet. I am out talking to a lot of different groups. I'd say what comes up for me a bit is, where is privacy going to fit? Does it fit in compliance? Does it fit in security? Does it fit in under like a application team or a chief technology officer, things like that? So I don't know that I see security necessarily as a compliance thing. Certainly privacy will be a compliance thing. It feels a lot like the regulated industries will get this, you know, by nature. But no, I'm not hearing that. But again, it's a good question.
Yeah, and I love this question because that's actually why we're talking to this group today. And I think hopefully if you stick with us through the end, what I think you'll pick up is that no, it's not about compliance. It should in some ways never be purely about compliance. My concern is that looking at everything as compliance means you have an answer, you answer it that way, you check the box, and you're done. And privacy is never done. It is always something you have to pay attention to every day. You learn new things about the way that you're using data. You have new vendors that you're working with that affect your systems and how data is used or secured. I mean, privacy is just as dynamic as security, but it's working alongside with security and very much hand in hand. So it's about having structures in place for really great communication among all your teams, but not expecting any one team to have all of the duties and responsibilities. Plus, you know, it shouldn't be seen as a burden. I mean, it's going to. After our talk, you're going to feel like this is a burden, and you might be annoyed by the fact that you're having forms shoved down your throat in conversations with privacy people that you didn't want to have. But hopefully you'll come at it differently, and you'll think of it as interesting and, you know, a chance to continue to learn, because this is about the way that consumers and human rights people are thinking about data now that we have really maybe not thought about before, and it's time for us to pay more attention to it. Great
yes,
question.
We're also increasingly starting to see, I think, companies using privacy as a differentiator as opposed to just having that sort of compliance mindset. We're seeing commercials on TV by companies like, you know, Apple and Uber, et cetera, who are advertising based on the fact that they're promising their users a certain level of privacy. So I think that's a shift we're starting to see as well. And it's not only because consumers are asking for it, but also there is more and more enforcement. We've seen following the General Data Protection Regulation in the EU, which came into force in 2018, we're starting to see some enforcement actions from the European data protection authorities there. But Cathy, maybe you can talk to us a little bit about the fact that, you know, the cost of breaches is going up both monetarily and reputationally, right?
Absolutely, yeah. So there's a Juniper research study that came out, I want to say it was August, September of last year, that quantified breaches to date in the $3 trillion level. And that's astounding. That's worldwide, and that's a lot of it is the fines. And I think one of the distinctions between privacy and security is security compliance, security adherence doesn't necessarily come with the big teeth bites of the privacy fines. So a good chunk of that is fines around the world, but a bigger chunk of that is brand impact. And we all see this. Facebook. The decision on Facebook biometrics came out this week. The value of Facebook plummeted by almost 2% of Facebook stock. So those are the kind of things that are, I think, going to continue to impact where we are in terms of the cost of privacy or non-compliance, I suppose. I keep using the word compliance, and you're like, it's not a compliance thing, but not really addressing privacy needs. So.
Well, and in respect of a comment that just came up, it is a compliance thing for sure. There's absolutely a fair amount of data protection, legal compliance that needs to be done, but the comment, and it's completely well taken, is that compliance is not check the box either. So
right.
It's an ongoing issue. One of the things that we're seeing companies struggle with, and this is not just U.S. Fortune 500, whom we've studied, by the way, and they absolutely consider cyber attack the number one information threat that they face. And when we dig deeper as to what that is, they say it's because they don't want to lose personal data. I mean, nobody wants to have their IP out the door, but they're more worried about losing personal data than anything else. And when we dig deeper and we say, well, what are you afraid of? Yeah, fines. But they budget for that and they have insurance for that. It's really the brand impact. That's their number one concern, their reputation, the issue of trust with their customers.
So I think you're right. Sure. And I would say beyond that, too, from a technology perspective, when you think about the implications of fines, brand, absolutely, there's a huge implication to that. But also, it can start to eat into your emerging technology budget. If you start to have to pay out fines in a big way, if you're smaller companies that are trying to really be innovative, you kind of lose your capital in order to really start investing, and you can see it kind of spiral in a bad way.
Right. We've kind of hinted at some of the major laws that are impacting companies' compliance requirements, but Rita, do you want to take us in to some of maybe the more nuanced provisions that are being included in regulations around the world?
Yeah, at a very high level, yeah. I think what we really want to illustrate is that most of those of us in the U.S. have been accustomed to, if there is any privacy law, it's personally identifiable information, PII, that's generally name and association with an account number, Social Security, some other highly personal information that could lead to a fraud or identity theft. That's sort of the world we live in. We are now in a different world where this is flipping the harms issue and saying essentially when you collect personal data, personal information, which is very broadly defined to be anything that could be reasonably related to a person, any human, when you collect that information from them, they are entitled to certain rights and rights to know. They need to know about it. If it's inaccurate, they want to be able to correct it, rectify it under European terminology. Maybe they don't want you to have it anymore. They've decided not to do business with you anymore, and they want to be taken out of your systems. They are starting to have the right to ask you to delete their information with some restrictions on it. They might be able, under European law, to say, you can't do that with my data. They can't say that for everything, but there are certain things that the law says they can actually object to your processing their data for certain functions. They might be able to tell you not to sell it. That's one of the things that you might want to do with it that they can tell you not to do. Now, that's unique to California law. The European law does not cover the sale of data. But in that issue with the right to sale, we start to tie into the fact that the law itself recognizes a huge ecosystem involving data. Data does not just live with the party to whom you gave it in the first place. frankly, you might have given it to another party thinking you were giving it to the business in the first place. It lives with many, many other parties along the way, and that's that supply chain where the contracts come in that I talked about. So these laws are starting to actually put required provisions in contracts, and yes, it touches the security team. They want the contracts to promise technical and organizational safeguards. Whatever that means, they want the party collecting and holding the data to have the right to inspect and audit and look into the practices of the third parties they're sharing data with. The California law even has provisions that affect the way that contracts are now drafted and worded, and they will affect the way that the parties actually deal with data between themselves. So it might be the legal team that has to negotiate these contracts, but they can't fulfill them without a lot of communication and support from the tech team. So if you haven't seen any of these yet, you most certainly will in the next few months, whether it's GDPR or CCPA that's causing these agreements to come your way.
And I would say, you know, the way I think about this too, front and center for the technology teams, is this puts your data strategy and the approach you have with data absolutely front and center. If you're a large enterprise with many, many years of systems, maybe some of your systems are 30, 40 years old in some cases, you need to know what data you have, why you collected it. You have to understand how to remove it. Things, how long you can retain it, things that maybe we hadn't thought about before. You need to know the difference between what you collected that was nice to have versus what you collected that is absolutely required to do business. And to Rita's point, as you look at data that you've sent to third parties, you need to know what you've sent. Have you sent them the minimum amount? And frankly, there's ways and tools that are becoming available that allow us to start automating this ability. I was talking to a CPO yesterday who said, I love automation because automation means I can automatically get my data retentions built in. I can know where and when and how to address some of these asks by consumers to understand and know and or delete their data.
Rita, do you want to talk about processor agreements or just like kind of let people?
Yeah, I mean, this is just more data that we've gathered from our members, and it just underscores the importance of the deal and the fact that parties are really asking some hard questions of each other, mostly obviously in the business-to-business space. So if you are a processor, if your core business is to host other companies' data so that they can manipulate it and do fancy things with it, then you're going to be scrutinized, hopefully, by your customers. And so it behooves you to come ready, to come prepared for that, to show them as soon as they ask, maybe before they ask, that you've thought through all these issues and you've built responsive systems and you've taken security seriously and you have a privacy officer and you're open for questioning and you can answer them intelligently. All of that makes you a better target for them. You're more likely to close the deal if you have all of those things in place.
Yeah. We've also heard, I think, extensively from regulators when we have them on stage at events, or you know, you may have seen regulators speaking in some of the headlines in the major newspapers, that if you do those things that Rita just mentioned, the regulators are going to look on you much more favorably when it comes time for enforcement. If you've made a good faith effort, right, to ensure those types of loopholes are closed, then they're going to be a little bit lighter on you when it comes to negotiating the punishment. Cathy, did you have something you wanted to add on to
Rita? Yeah, I did. So for me, this was a huge aha moment when I started mm-hmm. here. I had a technology procurement team under me in the past, and that sense that we are contractually or using contracts requires people to do the right thing. So I give you my money, my data, I contractually agree with you that you're only going to use it this way. That only goes so far. The new laws require that we actually build it in privacy by design. But automation, automation can provide some of the assurances that contracts can't. I think one of the key gotchas that technology folks really need to be thinking about, particularly technology procurement folks, is when we go and we build all these terms and conditions into the contract, who are we telling? Are we telling our engineers that this needs to be retained and only for a certain amount of time? Are we telling our engineers that we need to make sure that it's deleted within a certain period of time, or that only these people can have access to it, and so on and so on? And I guess on the flip side, as as large organizations or as organizations, are we asking that of our suppliers? Because contractually requires that you either audit or that, as this says, you either audit or you trust or whatever, but automation requires that we understand all the nuances of the terms and conditions of a contract to make sure we can build it that way.
And something I hear from practitioners in the privacy and security space often is that part of that, making sure that you're understanding terms and conditions, is making sure that your teams are speaking the same language or finding someone who can translate if not, right? And so making sure you can sit around a table and everyone has the same idea of what exactly we're talking about, what these terms mean in practice. Mm-hmm. And sometimes a translator is what you need, someone who's maybe straddled both fields and can understand how the engineering team is thinking versus how privacy counsel or security teams are thinking, right?
Exactly.
Yeah. Yeah. An interesting question, I think, that might be fun for us to talk about briefly before we move on to our next slide is, what are we learning from GDPR breaches, whether it be the profile of company or the types of breaches, and are they typically external attacks or internal weaknesses that haven't been addressed?
Wanted to prep for that question. So unfair.
Sounds like a Rita question.
Yeah, no, totally does sound like a Rita question, and Rita wants to say pass. Because, of course, a lot of the enforcement actions that we're seeing might have taken place from breaches that happened before GDPR took effect. And the definition of breach under the GDPR is super broad. It's any security incident, essentially, is a breach. So you're now talking, did you violate the GDPR with your breach? Did you not have the proper technical and organizational structures in place? Did you fail to follow the notification requirements? And so we have not seen a lot of enforcement actions that really go to failure to have notification in place and whatnot. We're still really early in the breach enforcement, but you know the biggest ones so far were Marriott and I think British Airways.
Mm-hmm.
And British Airways just posted data it shouldn't have to the public web. And the other one was a cyber attack, I think. So you know, both, I guess,
yeah,
we're seeing internal error, mm-hmm, and cybersecurity concerns. We all know though that the number one breach issues still happen through employee error. That's just the way that most personal data is usually accidentally exposed. And so you just have to be awfully careful that you are working with your counsel, that you use the word breach appropriately. It has different meanings under different laws.
Another question we have is, you know, how do we approach this given that there are so many emerging laws coming out? Is there any sort of framework that allows you sort of the flexibility and the umbrella to live underneath where you don't have to be as responsive to all of these laws that are coming out?
Mm. Funny you should ask. I'll just take the IAPP. It's the client that I have that I know the best, and we embrace GDPR as thoroughly as we possibly could. We've have created opt-in consents to absolutely everything. We've tried to be as responsive as possible to any access requests and any deletion requests, and we've just gone, I think, to strictly construe the law as possible, largely because we wanted to see what it felt like. We study ourselves,
mm-hmm,
and then we teach others what it feels like and what the results are, and we want to also model it in case anyone is also attempting to do what we're doing. And I'm not saying we're getting it all right. We're just trying to get it all right.
Mm-hmm.
And then we turned around and we applied this perspective, this practice, globally. There's two reasons for that. One is we felt like if it was good enough for the Europeans, it should be good enough for everyone. We shouldn't treat other people worse, if you will, from a data protection perspective. But also, we're a tiny company, and sometimes you can't have different systems for everybody. And thirdly, I guess, you know, in order to segment the world geographically, you actually need to collect personal data. And we are a huge data minimization company, and so we don't have that kind of information on our customers. So one size fits all was the practice that we started out with. However, I will say that a couple years in, it's not a perfect system. We're finding that even us, you know, even with our lofty ideals, are struggling with some of the consequences of having a global system. So I would say laws keep popping up all over. We've got Brazil, we've got India. We'll have other laws in the U.S. for a while before we have a federal uniform law. I am afraid that there are some things that you can build for everybody, but there are some things that you're going to have to customize, and our members are starting to tell us that they've done that too. They've tried to globalize where they can, but they have to localize for certain things.
It's probably a good point in this discussion to say your tech team has to be tightly working with your privacy officer, and your privacy officer has to be tightly working with your tech team, because as the laws continue to grow and emerge, you're going to have to adjust accordingly.
Cathy, can you talk to us a little bit about the proliferation of connected devices? We know that the Internet of Things is a really huge issue for many of our members. More and more toasters are going online every day. What of those devices, how is that impacting, you know, this where tech and law collide? And who does that data belong to anyway?
Oh, that's that last part of that question is a hard one. I'm gonna start at the beginning. So I love this picture here of a person that's really digital, their bits and bytes and things like that, because as you can see from the numbers, there is a lot of connected devices out there. These are your smart phones, they're your smart watches, they're your smart homes, they're everywhere. We are creating so much data every single day that essentially between location tracking and tracking where you go, your social media, who your friends are, we can literally create a digital version of people. Mm. And so there's this whole concept, which is probably a little bit bigger concept of than we maybe want to discuss today, but is privacy a human right? And which is kind of where the last part of your question is, like, who owns your data? I think, you know, thinking about us as people, like our human people, we think we have, you know, it's our eyes, it's our ears, it's our whatever. But when it comes to our data, it's everywhere. And so while there is this concept of a digital citizen, and this is something I get from a colleague who I respect so much, this concept of a digital citizen, that digital citizen it's everywhere, right? It's sprawled everywhere, this all the data that you can pull together to make up. And you don't really know who knows what about you. And I think that's the creepy part of some of the things that are happening here.
Do you want to add anything? Let's take another question. This one is on data anonymization. So the question is, will there be clear directions on what data has to be protected? As you stated, the lawyers talk about reasonable data protection, but it seems they aren't giving clear guidelines.
Well, because it's a term of, like, a term of art, right? It's a defined term. What is anonymization as opposed to pseudonymization, as opposed to de-identification? And these are all actually legal terms, or could have legal consequences. The short answer is the guidelines are data is only anonymous, i.e. it is not personal data, if it can never be connected to any person. That's how it goes. So how you technically turn personal data into anonymized data depends on your data set and what personal data you're talking about.
And where you provide it, where you make it public, who can see it, and who maybe has access to other data sets.
Yeah, so I mean, the guidelines are it can never be tied to a natural person, an actual human being, and then it's anonymous, and then it's not personal data, and you can do whatever you want with it. I don't know if that answers the question, but
maybe this is a question for both of you. This one is, how will cyber theft be held to the same legal standard as physical theft in today's age of digital assets?
So I think the challenge with cyber theft is who perpetrated it. So in terms of it's being held to the same standards, I think it's tough. I think it's a lot tougher for enforcement. You think about a lot of the towns that are being held hijacked with malware and things like that. It is nearly impossible in many cases, unless human behavior gets involved and starts bragging, which happens, right? It's nearly impossible to find out who did it. I think that until we have some additional technology capabilities to sort of find who is perpetrating those crimes. And until we really have some consequences that can act as a deterrent, it's a tough one.
Right, and I mean, this is a jurisdictional question as well, and it kind of ties in a very loose way with another question up there, which is, all right, I don't live in your country, so what do I care about your laws? And that's sort of true of a cyber criminal. If they're not physically in the country, or even, you know, even the state where the crime is felt, where the impact is where the victim lives, then you have a massive jurisdictional problem. You have not just to ensure that they're subject to the laws that govern their behavior, and there are plenty of cybercrime laws in the U.S. that make it illegal to access someone's computer and harm it or take data from it, but how do you enforce that? How do you not just find them but enforce? And that's the same thing, honestly, with civil law. It is not easy for the California Attorney General's Office to hold a Canadian company accountable for violating California law, even if they're subject to it by the state, you know, by what the law says. There will be certain circumstances where they'll be willing to go to town and try to enforce it, but it isn't easy. It's just part of the problem with the internet, with the global nature of the web. But that doesn't mean that countries aren't working together to try to cooperate on the criminal side as well as on the civil side. And that doesn't mean that it isn't still a good business decision to comply with other countries' laws, just because why would you want to expose yourself if you don't have to? And maybe the laws make sense. Like, I mean, might be a good idea.
Sort of an interesting question that sort of ties into what we were talking about with Cathy earlier on who owns your data. And there have been some emerging thoughts, I think, about could users be compensated for their data? You know, there's this adage now that, you know, if the service is free, you're paying with yourself, basically. Mm-hmm. And so how could we turn that into sort of a system? How could we codify that? And so there are some startups I've actually seen now who are working on models where they would figure out some sort of valuation, and how they come up with that number, I'm not sure, of how to pay users for their data so that it's more of a reciprocal balanced relationship. But the question is, what about emerging compensation rights, the right to be paid for the use of your PII? That is, if a provider uses your information, compensation would be provided. Do you think we're ever going to see that kind of world, or is that nonsensical? Cathy?
So as you were describing it, Angelique, I was thinking, we used to do this, right? I remember being a kid or a young adult living in Boston, and I remember going and getting paid, you know, $50 to do a survey of my data. So, I mean, I don't think monetizing our information is new. I think the difference is we had consent because there was no other way other than to ask earlier, you know, not to age myself, but earlier, you had to go and physically fill out a survey, right? I think now the question is, I think we can monetize our data. I think there are always going to be ways that we do that. We do it sort of today where we are, we're giving up our data for a free subscription. That's kind of a form of monetization, right? But I think the bigger, more gnarly problem, if you will, be to solve is that our data isn't in our control. So to say, I'm going to charge you for my data when you can perhaps go out and get it for free, or the less happy path is that someone's going to go buy your data in a nefarious way because they've hacked it or stolen it or they have access to it or things like that. So it's intriguing. I would say the ability to monetize our data at the personal level, that would be very, very tough to do.
Yeah, and I mean, the CCPA accounts for this in a way because it essentially says, you know, people are monetizing their data all the time. It just doesn't look like money. It looks like points or, you know, some sort of coupon or offer or, frankly, even better targeted services. So, you know, if I use the Starbucks app, it certainly facilitates my purchase, which I love, but it also gives me points, and at some point I get free coffee. So I've kind of monetized my data by that occasional reward that they give me, and that would be true of any reward program. So CCPA says, go for it, have a rewards program, but you can't discriminate against people. If you know they don't want to participate, you can't hold them, you know, to force them essentially to sell their data if they don't want to, or you can't charge them a different price and discriminate against them if they're either not participating or they fall into some class. So the CCPA thinks about it. It kind of awkwardly tries to get there, not very well, but it makes an effort, a passing effort, to acknowledge the fact that we're all monetizing our data every day as many times as possible.
Okay, let's move on to some more of these slides so we can try and get through as many of them as possible. I think, Cathy, this one's going to lead us into talking about this privacy by design.
Okay, so privacy by design. This is actually a concept that was, these foundational principles were built back in 1995. So it's amazing to me that we're just now kind of getting to the point where we're talking about them, where the laws are actually requiring them. And I actually heard someone last week call this legal by design, making sure that we're compliant by design. So essentially, there's these seven principles of privacy by design. They essentially align to the principles that Rita talked about earlier, making sure that we are building into our applications all those rights of that the laws require. So, and this really changes, as the slide indicates, it changes the way we plan. As I mentioned earlier, we don't just have to talk from a data perspective about what we need today, but we need to start thinking about what we need in the future. If we have data and we're done using it for what we needed and we want to use it for something else, we've got to find a way to go back out and get consent for it, for example. So how we design our applications, how we build them, how we maintain them, that all kind of changes with privacy in mind. And then we've talked, you know, ad nauseum probably about the third-party software. But the privacy by design principles really get to making sure we are, by default, ensuring privacy, that we are embedding it in to our everything that we build, whether it's the system, the process, or the application that people use. It is ensuring that we are respecting the data from the time we get it to the time that we are done with it and that we are actively destructing it. It is, in a very familiar security term, it is trusting but verifying, making sure that we are very transparent about what we're doing with people's data and that people have the right, as Rita talked about earlier, to know not just to ask to have it removed, but also to know what we're doing with it and things like that. And I guess at the heart of these, it's that keeping the user in the center of everything that we do, which when we think about design thinking and a lot of the new ways we're building systems, that customer centricity, that user centricity, it is very much in line with how we think about it. It just goes that much deeper in terms of making sure we understand how they want us to use their data.
Yeah, so, I mean, just a totally obvious practical example, any new app that is built that would go on a mobile device, you know, at the point of generating the app, you're going to have to say, well, what's the function of the app, and does it do anything that would feel like someone's uncomfortable with how their data is used, and what data do we need to make the app function properly? So if it's a video game, you know, it's a touch, like a little eat something or race something around or whatever, do you actually need to know the name and address of the child that's playing that? Probably not. You know, how much do you need to know about the device it's running on? How much do you need to know the location of the person who's playing it at that moment? Do you need to know who their friends are? You know, all of these things are questions that you would ask at the point of coding, really, as well as where that data will live, where it's hosted, and what other parties will see it and access to it, advertisers and whatnot. So you can build in, maybe you commercially don't want to, but you could build in an app that gathers almost no data, and therefore there's very little to worry about from a privacy perspective. And if it does have to collect data, is it the kind of data where someone needs to say, yes, that's okay with me first? And if so, then you need to ask them, literally, in the app, at the moment that you're collecting it, hey, I want to get this, is it okay? All of that's designing in, thinking about data usage from the beginning.
And I think the biggest nut to crack going forward is not so much the build by design, it's the look back. It's the look back on all the legacy systems, as
that's
I mentioned
true.
Earlier. We've got oodles and oodles and oodles of data that we have gathered over the years, again, coming off of this huge era, we're not even leaving it, but the years, the last 3-5 years of big data, creating big data lakes and machine learning becoming that, you know, bright and shiny object that we love to work with now, we really have to think seriously about going back and looking at those systems and making sure that we're with privacy in mind, that we're looking at and adjusting those. And training, I mean, learning, this is huge for learning. And as Rita said earlier, this is everyone's responsibility, but we really need to figure out how we start to build our applications with privacy in mind.
This before we ran out of time.
Yeah. I was just thinking when you were talking about going back through data pools and systems and sort of rethinking and cleaning up, I was talking to someone the other day and they were referring to it as like the Japanese declutterer Marie Kondo. She sort of goes through all of the clutter and you look at the item and say, does this bring me joy? Do I want to bring this with me into my future? And if not, you thank it for being a part of your life and you move on. It's sort of like that with data, right? Like, do you really need this data? Is it completely essential to what you're doing? If not, get rid of it. Let's move on, because one thing that we want to make sure that we do touch on is the new NIST framework that recently came out, or I guess it's been a couple months now, but we've had a couple questions on the list about this, and we know it's something that privacy and security practitioners are really looking at as emerging guidance. Rita, do you want to kick this off? Cathy, do you want to kick this off? I just got a note.
Yeah, sure. So the NIST privacy framework, actually, it was a collaborative effort. It had policy folks, it had technology folks, it had business folks, all involved in collaboratively launching it. I know they started back in September of 2018, and they had a pretty rapid march as they went through with multiple iterations being reviewed on a regular basis. The version 1.0 for the privacy framework was just released on January 16th. And it was released very much in line with a lot of support, as I mentioned, from folks. And while we recognize that it is not the security NIST framework, and there was a point in time, from what I understand, where they were going to create a framework, it is a side-by-side framework. And I highly encourage anyone to go out and look this up and really digest it, because it has a lot of guidance, just like security, when the NIST security framework came out in 2014, I think it really helped organizations think through in a very organized fashion what they needed to do. So if you look at the framework itself, and I'm not going to go through this in detail because you all, security folks, I'm sure, are quite familiar with the NIST privacy framework, but you can see where the overlap lies in terms of the different control areas. So identify cyber, there's identify P, which is for privacy, and it's very, very similar. So this would be a tool that I would think security professionals would be very comfortable with. And when it comes to the privacy breach and how to respond to a breach, it actually lifts forward a lot of the security practices that are already in existence and just layers on top some privacy practices.
The question we have is, how is this different from security by design? Security by design covers. I was just going to finish the question. Is that security by design covers both security and privacy? Shouldn't both be of equal relevance and import?
So security by design is its confidentiality, its availability, its integrity. It's making sure you have the walls up so people that shouldn't get in can't get in. It's making sure it's available so people can't take it down, right? And it's making sure that only the right people have access to it, whether to read it, to change it, or whatever. Privacy takes it in a different direction. It is about the data itself. It is about making sure the data itself is protected and use. It is not about whether or not you can get to it or not. It's about how you use it, so to speak. And privacy comes with security, but they are quite different. And actually, I think there's the next slide probably has a little bit of a distinction that helps. So. The way I think about it in my mind, security is about rules and restrictions. It's about making sure that you have things stood up. You've got the locks on the doors, and you have maybe the passcode at the office that only certain people can get into certain parts of an office, for example. But privacy is about the content. It's about how you, the context of what you have and how you use it. And that requires a little bit different thinking. To me, cyber and security framework really came up, and so I'll speak as an engineer. It's a very natural fit for engineers for us to say we can put these walls in place, we can. But I'll go back to sort of the point of this is why it is so important that the DPO or CPO and the technologists are working together, because privacy is about how you use the information. And as engineers, we don't necessarily we're building the applications perhaps, but we're not necessarily the owners of the business aspects of why we're collecting the data or what the data is or how to use it or retention. So to me, they are privacy sort of takes security up a whole nother layer. And you can't have privacy without security, but you can certainly have security without privacy.
Okay.
I hope that answered the question.
Yeah, I think that was great. Well, we have time for maybe two more questions, and then we're going to wrap. Rita, maybe you can help us out with this one. This was something that we saw when the CCPA was being negotiated, was sort of a hot topic in terms of people being compensated for their data. We heard a lot about rewards programs and how that was going to fit into the law. So this question is, supermarkets charge higher prices for customers that don't have affinity cards that allow the supermarket to track all your purchases. You just said that the law doesn't allow discriminating for people that don't want their data collected.
thank you for making me uncomfortable. After the CCPA was the first version came out, the amendments were, you know, offered and to clarify that loyalty programs are not illegal. So for sure, supermarkets and their lawyers are going to find a way to make sure that they're not considered to be discriminating against you because you don't want it to be tracked for your every move. You know what? That is just dancing around the issue, and I'm with you. It feels discriminatory that I don't want the supermarket to know that I bought all these things, although they probably know it anyway. But I think that as long as the card is issued agnostically and everyone gets the exact same experience who has the card, they're going to say that loyalty programs are now acceptable under the CCPA, and that's just the world we live in. Sorry.
All right, last question here. Any thoughts on end-to-end encryption and legislative bodies trying to create backdoors?
Ooh, that's a tough one. Kathy, would you like to talk about
it?
We don't take positions, by the way. Yeah. We're policy neutral. But yeah, it's such a great question because what a clash between, you know, these hardware and software companies making privacy their brand and then having their own government fight with them over that decision making. And it's a big reason why we in the U.S. are stuck doing all sorts of gymnastics to try to get data from Europe to the U.S. Under the GDPR, because we're not, you know, we've never applied for or sought adequacy under the GDPR, in part because our government does want to be able to gain access to certain data and work with corporate partners to be able to see what's going on. So I don't see it being fixed anytime soon, and I always just watch with fascination while Apple and FBI go at it. Do you have any thoughts?
No.
I will say that I, as a reporter, a journalist for the IAPP, I spend a lot of my time on Capitol Hill watching hearings, debating this topic right now is of significant importance. We saw it in the San Bernardino attacks, you know, that law enforcement wanted access to the iPhone, and the privacy world is up in arms over this. That, you know, if we have weak policies and loopholes like this, that it makes everyone less safe in terms of privacy overall. It's something that continues to be a really contentious topic on the Hill in terms of companies, like you said, trying to promise consumers privacy, and the government saying, well, do you want terrorist attacks to happen? You know, do you want the public to be at risk? We're at a time where we're in dangerous times, you know, and so there doesn't seem to be a clear-cut answer yet. I see it as being, you know, it's a tug of war, and every time we seem to get a little bit closer to having a winner, the next hearing pulls it back the other way, and there are really, you know, strong arguments on either side and very passionate people on either side of it as well. Rita, you want to follow up with that?
Yeah, I just think that, I mean, if we can separate our professional world for just a minute and think about ourselves as citizens of a country that values civil liberties very highly and has incredibly strong civil rights under the U.S. Constitution, another place that law and tech will collide in 2020 is with free speech and the use of the internet, and in particular political advertising and misinformation campaigns online. It's not that that's new to 2020. We all know that's been going on for a long time, but this is a massive election year, mm-hmm. and Congress people are talking about, you know, and really putting pressure on tech platforms to scale back who can post what and to monitor and to actually get engaged in suppressing speech, because it's harmful. And what are the long-term consequences of some of our near-term clear First Amendment rights or Fourth Amendment rights? I mean, it's extraordinary how all of a sudden maybe we do or do not hold these quite as dear as we thought we did. Or maybe we do. Maybe we're purists about it. And then there are just consequences. There are security consequences, and there are election consequences that come out of holding true to these very pure constitutional principles and rights. So,
yeah, and I would say technology in some places, too, takes us a bit further in terms of ethics, if you will, and it's starting to require ethical engineering. So you think about an autonomous vehicle and the need for a programmer to code. Does the person who is in the car have the right to live if there's an inherent accident that's about to happen, or does the person who's on the sidewalk have the right to live? And so that whole aspect of how we leverage technology to actually build ethical decisions in, it's just going to get more and more complex.
We have come to the end of our presentation. We appreciate your attention and all of your very thoughtful questions. As Brenna mentioned at the beginning, you can listen to this again after the fact. RSA will distribute the link and the slides. Yes, we had a question on this. The slides will be available as well. So thanks again for joining us, and have a great rest of your day.